The NHL has returned. The Flyers trounced the Penguins. Joel Farabee has a day and more. You're listening to episode 2, Sticks Up High.
Now the Flyers may even this up. Konechny gets sticks up high, sticks up high, sticks up high.
Welcome to Sticks Up High, a PhillySportsNetwork.com production. I'm your host, Matt Stinger, also known as Delco Dope on Twitter, where you can follow along there, follow along here, or follow along on Facebook. Sticks Up High, PhillySportsNetwork.com. Yes, indeed, we are back. The NHL is back. The Philadelphia Flyers are back. This is episode 2 of Sticks Up High. Once again, I am your host, Matt Stinger. Thanks for joining us. The Flyers start the season as good as you can expect. They could have shut them out, but they didn't. But they doubled up the Penguins, beating them 6-3, obviously. You probably know that if you're paying attention and listening to this podcast. However, we're going to go through a little bit of the game notes. We're going to go through some stats and figures, and we're going to talk about a couple of the players and how they performed last night, some of my observations. I got a good announcement towards the end of the program about what's coming up on the second episode. So I'm sorry, the third episode, second episode we'll do this week, or of the season, I guess, as the season started. So let's start off with what was going on last night. So the Flyers hosted the Penguins in a early evening game, obviously. We all know that, but it starts the season off with a great rivalry. I mean, it was fantastic. So just let's hit on some notes from the games. First off, it was Travis Konechny's 300 games, so that's a nice little milestone for his young career. 12 different Flyers scored at least 1 point, and three had multi-point games. I mean, that's just fantastic. One of the things I think we could all look back on in terms of the bubble was that the scoring we wanted to get more out of everybody. And I mean, four lines were rolling last night. You had 11 of your 12 forwards register a point. You had one defenseman register multiple points. Obviously, Gustafsson. You had, obviously, Joel Farabee just went off and had himself a day with a goal and three assists. Kevin Hayes, a goal and an assist. And they're your three multi-point getters last night. And, you know, just a really, really good start. All-around offensive start. The Flyers looked really tough. They hard on the puck. Kevin Hayes is just a magician with his hands. My goodness. I don't know. It's like you can't even get the puck off him. Some other notes, Oscar Lindblom, he had three block shots and three hits to go with his goal. And Nicholas Aubé-Kubel led the Flyers with seven hits. And let's talk 1 second about Aubé-Kubel. We'll get to that fourth line a little bit, but my man is strong. Guentzel found out the hard way when he attempted to take on Nick, and Nick just kind of exploded him. So let's just continue on with some of the game facts. Six goals or more was the most the Flyers have scored in a home opener since 2000, when they took on the Vancouver Canucks and beat them, ironically, by a score of 6-3 to start the 2000-2001 season, so 20 years ago. And it is only not 20 years ago, because that obviously would have been in October. Nobody starts the season in January, really. It's only the fourth time in Flyers history where they scored six or more in an opener, and all four have been at home. It's just the first home opener win at the Wells Fargo Center since 2003, which is that's surprising. And at that time, they beat the Maple Leafs 2-0. It's their fifth consecutive road win, opening night win, and the last one, obviously, was last year, if it was five in a row. Come on, Matt, get your head out of your rear end. And obviously, that was a home game, but it was in Prague, Czech Republic, so it didn't count at the Wells Fargo Center, and the other three were on the road. All right, some other game stats for you. Obviously, the score 6-3. The Penguins outshot the Flyers 34-25, where the Flyers led in faceoff percentage with 58% of the faceoffs. Each team had three power plays, with the Flyers converting two of their three man advantages, and the Pens converted one of three. The Flyers outhit the Penguins 31-23, and they had more blocks with 13-11. Your goal scorers were James Van Riemsdyk, Nolan Patrick, Joel Farabee, Michael Roffel, Oscar Lindblom, and Kevin Hayes. And your assists were Farabee had three, Gustafson two, and Hayes, Travis Konecny, Sean Couturier, Scott Laughton, Claude Giroux, and Abe Kubel each had one. Your time on the ice leader was, surprise, surprise, Ivan Provorov with 23 minutes even. And second was Phil Myers, 21 minutes and 3 seconds. And as for the backstop, Carter Hart, he had 31 saves on 34 shots for a .912 save percentage. I think Hart looked really, really good. I think he kind of... The two goals he let up on his shots were pretty tough. They were pretty tough lateral movements. The one was a weird deflection. The first goal, we'll get into it a little bit, but you know, he'll tell you he wanted them back. The second goal, obviously that errant pass attempt or clearing attempt where Crosby knocked it down. Again, we'll get into it in a little bit, but I thought Hart was really good. Good lateral movement. He seemed square to the puck most of the night. Didn't give up many rebounds and even had to deal with a little friendly fire with some of the deflections on goal, but he was equal to the task and able to come away with a home win, which is not unusual for him. And again, the Flyers take a team approach and are able to beat the Penguins 6-3. We'll get into the game here a little bit. It wasn't a one-sided affair like the score may have thought, or you thought if you just saw the score. They went back and forth. The Penguins jumped out to lead in the first period. So stand by here as we're going to get to it.
Let's go Flyers! Let's go Flyers!
All right, so as we get into the game, the game starts out, as you would think, the first game of the season with the shortened camp and no preseason games. We're a little bit rusty. The teams were feeling themselves out when the Penguins scored first with about 5 minutes and 13 seconds into the first period. It was a goal by Mark Jankowski, the new Penguins player that was a free agent pickup by the Pens. A little bit on that play. The Penguins got the puck in deep. They were fighting for it. There was a good forecheck on their part. Bodies going around the net. It looked as though the Flyers got caught in a little bit of a defensive rotation where Voracek came down from his wing behind and ended up being behind the net on JVR's side, the left side. And if I say left or right wing, just know I mean the Flyers' perspective, not the Penguins. And you know, as the puck kind of went towards the right wing side, you see Patrick rotate over to Voracek's spot to cover that wing in that point, and also to cover the try and get the clearance, clear the puck out of the zone, and start the other way. Well, that was kind of where the breakdown was because you had Voracek, Braun, and Provorov down low with Jankowski. Jankowski was on the backside there with nobody near him. And JVR was high center man there. Would like to have seen him rotate down and cover him, but the Flyers end up getting caught all watching the puck in the right wing corner, or the right corner there. The centering pass deflects off Provorov right to Jankowski, and he buries one. It was one of those goals, you know. It's a movement left to right. Carter Hart was there, but again, I think if you watch him tracking the puck, he's probably thinking the puck's going up higher, and when it deflects off Provorov, it's right on Jankowski's stick, and he buries it. Penguins take the lead 1-0. A little bit more of the same, back and forth. The Flyers are looking to try and establish their forechecking. There are a lot of one and outs. You know, we've seen that, especially like against the Islanders in the bubble. And they continue to work. And there was a lot of where you're seeing the play develop. I thought during the first period that the Giroux-Hayes-Farabee line looked pretty good at points where they were a lot of offensive zone pressure. At one point, I think they spent like 50-some seconds in the zone on one shift. So they were getting their chances. And then Voracek, who, although he wasn't on the score sheet and only registered one shot, I think he had a really good game. I think Jake had his legs moving. And when Jake gets his legs moving and he's rumbling through, that's when he causes problems. And he did. And when he had that, he's going into the zone. A penalty to the Penguins defender, Cody Ceci, slashes Jake. Jake continues to play, centering past to Gustafson, who rips a shot, and it actually gets through Jarry, but sits behind him and stays there. The Penguins touch the puck, and the Flyers go on the power play. So the power play, you know, one thing you think about is with the limited camp, they didn't really get a chance to work that much on it. Were they going to be rusty, whatnot? The first power play unit comes out there for the first 30-some seconds of the power play. They're in the zone, passing a puck, a couple of shots. Hayes had a shot on Jarry, and then another shot blocked, and then they cleared a puck. The Penguins cleared a puck, and then that's it for the Flyers' power play unit. They get into the zone again, and then they don't set anything up. And enter power play unit number two. All right, so power play number two comes on, and Nolan Patrick and Jake Voracek move the puck up and into the zone, and Jake's on the right wing side there. The interesting thing, if you didn't see it, JVR had a really nice play to keep the puck in the zone. The Penguins pressure Voracek on that right side. I believe it's Voracek. And yeah, that's correct. Voracek goes for the self-pass off the boards, but the Penguins defender gets to it and tries to clear the zone. JVR makes a nice play by getting at least a piece of it and knocking it down. Patrick to Gustafson. Gustafson cross ice to Farabee, and Farabee now on the left side, obviously a left-handed shot, goes up the boards, and he draws, I think it's Rodriguez, as he draws him in, a nice little backhanded pass to Gustafson, who rips it, deflects off JVR. 1-1 tie game, and power play two is making it mark, something that was needed by the Flyers. They needed a power play two. It seemed in the recent years almost just non-existent. So it's nice to see that the power play two and their first chance gets one on the board for the orange and black. And that goal comes in 15 minutes, 11 seconds in the first period, almost exactly 10 minutes after the Penguins goal. So the game continues. It's, again, back and forth. The team's just feeling them out. So with less than a minute remaining, Malkin plays like Malkin does, dirty, and goes for a trip on Couturier when TK says, nope, not going to have it, and goes to hit Malkin. Well, Matheson, Penguin defender Matheson, decides, nope, neither am I having it. And he cross-checks Konechny into the boards. Flyers go on a power play with 15 seconds remaining in the power play, and it took them all of 8 seconds to score their second power play goal. Now, what's interesting here is with 8 seconds left, AV rode the hot hand. He puts out power play number two. I wish I could have asked him why, but he puts them out. Patrick wins the draw to Gustafson. Gustafson to Farabee. Farabee back to Gustafson, who blasts it. Patrick redirects, deflects off his body, I believe his leg, and in for the goal. 2-0. Correction, 2-1. That's the way the period ends. Those last minute goals, which are killers, but great for the Flyers. period number two begins, and the Flyers end up going a man down, and they pay for it. Sidney Crosby, once again, you know, I mean, whatever you want to say about hating the guy, and we hate him because he's so damn good. He is ridiculous out there. I mean, what a strong man. Like, you can't get him off the puck. His strength and balance are ridiculous. He plays the game in such a way that it's the little things that you might not notice. Like, he's always in the right spot. You know, he's always winning. If I were to be down there, I might have asked Carter Hart, like, what he was thinking on that clearing attempt. If it was something that was, he didn't know it was Crosby. Did he foresee Crosby going back around to play the backhand behind the net? But regardless, even if Crosby was doing that, he knew exactly where to go. He read the play perfectly. He knocks the puck down, and as he's almost skating away, he just flicks it with his wrist for the goal. So he ties the game up on a power play. Other than that, the Flyers shut down Crosby pretty much the rest of the night. And let's not, like, Crosby looked good out there. He was in his spots. He was moving. I mean, I don't remember who went on the hit, but the little spinorama to make the Flyers guy look foolish and just right around him. It was Crosby's looking like Crosby this year. And you know, that's not good for the Flyers, obviously, but he is an amazing player, and from what I understand, he's an amazing person, too. We'll get more on that in the next episode. And Crosby's goal comes at the 3-minute, 39-second mark of the second period. And the score remains 1-1 for the majority of the second period until the end again with at 18:54 in the period. Kevin Hayes finds a wide-open Joel Farabee down low, who sneaks it right underneath Jarry's pad and glove or blocker for another late period goal. It could be backbreakers here, but the Penguins do bounce back. But it is end of the second. Flyers do go ahead 3-2. Takes a 3-2 lead into the third period. So the third period then begins, and the Penguins take advantage. A good shot. Again, it is a Jankowski again. Making plays. The guy looks good. He really does. It's Brandon Tanev cross ice coming off the bench. Cross ice pass again. Lateral movement for Hart. And Tanev buries it. Hart didn't really have a chance. He almost got in a position, but just not enough time. So 3:01 of the third period. Tanev ties it up 3-3. It didn't last long as, again, the quote-unquote fourth line of the Flyers are doing what they can do, which is they can put the puck in the net. And this is just one of those awesome things to talk about. Like, Raffle gets the goal. Albi Kubel does the work to get the puck in to Lawton, who takes a little quick peek over his shoulder, sees Raffle coming, tape-to-tape pass, and it's buried. At 5:37, Flyers take the lead. And again, more of the same, back and forth. Couple penalties here, power plays there, or one power play. And the next goal is Oscar Lindblom. Like I said, Couturier coming in before. He just patiently waits, slides the puck to Lindblom, who has I think he got a stick tied up, but he is digging the puck in front of Jarry. He's kicking at it, and it squirts the Konechny, who rips a shot and apparently glances off Lindblom's helmet. And Lindblom had the goal changed. It originally went to Konechny, and also Nolan Patrick. This is kind of a weird turn of events. Both players back on their first game get their goals. Both initially had them credited to a different person, and once the scorers went back to it, they see that they were, in fact, touched last by Lindblom and Patrick. So it doesn't end the scoring there. Then, again, one more rush at the 12:34 mark, just 30 seconds after Lindblom's goal. Kevin Hayes buries a rebound that Farabee shot on net. So Hayes gets his second point, his first goal. Farabee gets his fourth point, his third assist, and Giroux gets on the score sheet. 6-3 ends that way. bring them on Friday's the next game. So we're looking forward to it. A couple things with the players I wanted to point out. I thought Phil Myers had a really good game. I think he looks really strong back there. Looked really strong on the blue line. Good stick, puck movement. I thought the defense in general really jumped on the play really well. You know, they really did a good job of pinching and keeping that puck in the zone when they had to. I think Gustafson obviously had a really good game. He moves the puck really well. It's nice to see him. And you know, there really wasn't any of the defender mistakes that kind of like you go, oh, what was that? I mean, you had the one errant pass by Carter Hart, who just today said, you know, he wants that back, but he thought Crosby got lucky on it. But he is Sidney Crosby and one of the best players in the world, which I find is a great quote for a young player looking to be the greatest player in the world, is that he's like, yeah, he got lucky. I mean, it's Sidney Crosby. He's been doing that for a living, you know, and our goalie's just like, hey, he got lucky knocking that down, but I want that one back. You know, great reaction from Carter Hart. So 6-3 Flyers win. Again, I know I've said that probably 7-8 times in the past couple minutes, but you know what? The best part is we got to talk about it. We got to just keep remembering 6-3, 6-3. Yes. You know, we jump out to that. We look so much better than the Penguins did. We pretty much, you know, we made Malkin look pedestrian out there. He just looked disinterested, you know. Kevin Hayes kind of made him look silly a couple times with Deeks around him. But the main thing is we would have shut they would have shut Crosby down. I wasn't playing. I play C men's league. I don't play out there. So I say we because I've been a Flyers guy for my whole life. But they shut down Crosby for the most part, and that potent front line of him, Rust, and now Rodriguez. So, you know, the Albe Kubel, man, again, like I said, that kid is strong. Man, he's strong. Guentzel went to go for that hit, or they kind of collided, and Guentzel went flying. Yeah, it was a type of hit where the violence of the impact, I don't know if anybody else was out there, but, I mean, it was a completely clean hit, but once you see that like violent flying into the boards that happened to Guentzel, you're like, all right, here's a penalty. But the refs didn't call it, and that was the right non-call. And you know, again, that guy is just tough. And it's going to be interesting to see that last line. And you know, they played a lot of minutes against Crosby, and that frees up the other three to be the, you know, go offensive, you know, and that's huge with those, with Lawton Raffel and Albe Kubel all on the penalty kill. You know that AB now has that trust in him. So it was just a great game. It was great to see Joel Farabee come out and play that well. Now he is playing with Claude Giroux, and G makes everybody better. I mean, G is just so good at the subtleties that you don't know how good he is, but he sees everything. He sees the game really well, and he also draws attention, which will free up Farabee, as does Hayes. So, I mean, you know, with any luck, we're talking about Farabee every night having a point a night average. He does have the skill. He put in the effort, and it showed in his first game. In fact, you know, let's go back to how he talked last night about his game, and more important, actually not really his game, but his preparation coming in to the season and what he needed to work on.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, during camp, I feel a lot more comfortable this year. You know, I think we had some great additions to our team this year. I feel like we have, you know, four really good lines. All our D are really strong. So I think as a team, we're just feeling really good. You know, I just happened to, you know, get a little lucky tonight with some bounces and stuff like that, but overall, I thought our team play was really good, and you know, we have a lot to build off of that.
And speaking of Farabee and his progression, this is what head coach Alain Vigneault had to say about him.
You know, I believe that him putting the time and the effort that he did this summer shows, you know, his willingness to work on becoming the best player that he can be. And there's no doubt that there, you know, there's a lot of skill and tools in Joel, but he's putting in the time and the effort, and that's what players need to do. And tonight he came up real strong for us. I thought that line was effective. Their willingness to go to the nets, stop in front was evident. And there's no doubt that Joel was a big part of you know, that line and the two goals that we got on the power play getting the job done for us.
And just to wrap it up, Joel Farabee has himself a game. He is the NHL points leader at the moment, and he just came into the season. He put the work in the offseason, came in stronger, and kind of with the mentality of what now he knows he has to do, something that he learned last year by playing at the NHL level. So, again, the Flyers start off the season the right way, 6-3 win over the hated Pittsburgh Penguins, and we're back at it Friday night again from the Wells Fargo Center and the same Penguins. So let's go. Let's see how it goes, and let's go Flyers.
To all the Warriors, thank you for your service.
Yes, indeed. To all my fellow veterans out there, thank you for your service to this wonderful, great nation. And this now brings us to the Warriors Minute, as I like to call it. Just the other couple days ago, it was released via the Flyers Warriors Instagram and Twitter that, yes, indeed, we are back. In fact, we have a game this Saturday, and it is in Johnstown versus the Johnstown Generals. So all the months of waiting and practicing for the Warriors has paid off, as one of the teams will head west Saturday morning to take on the Generals at 11:45. I'm still trying to figure out some details and if and where you can see the game, but should let you know prior to the game via Instagram and Twitter, Facebook, and such. And on that note, the other day I had the opportunity to join a fellow veteran who just retired last year and on his podcast, Talking Philly Sports with Matty B. And he asked about the Warriors and how to get involved. He asked what the Warriors were actually was. So, you know, I directed him obviously to the Facebook page, which is where most of the information is. But just so you know, and if you don't know, I will say it again here time and time again. I'll say it again here that the Philadelphia Flyers Warriors is a hockey program that is dedicated to providing hockey to disabled U.S. military veterans. It gives the veterans an opportunity to get together with other veterans and like-minded individuals. And, you know, in some cases, the hockey is cause for healing and helping some of these fine men and women get over some of their service-related injuries and disabilities or wounds. So if you are a veteran, if you are a veteran who plays hockey and is looking to play hockey, head on over to the Facebook page. You can check out some of the pictures on Instagram and the Twitter page. You can send a message on Facebook again, and also reach out to the PhiladelphiaWarriorHockey@gmail.com for an email if you want information on how to volunteer, become a member of the organization. So again, the Warriors are back at it on Saturday, taking on the Johnstown Generals, and it should be an exciting time. I will be covering it, and hopefully I'll be able to have some good stuff come Sunday at the end of what we hope to be the first victory of the 2021 Warrior season. Also, looking to have some more Warrior news throughout the year, so stay connected to the Warriors Facebook and Instagram page and the Twitter account, and also I'll be posting them out on Delco Dope and also the Sticks Up High Twitter, Facebook, and so forth. So good luck, Warriors. Let's get it done this weekend against the Generals. All right, and that brings us to the end of the program here. We talked a lot of hockey, and this is just great to be back, and I love to be back talking hockey. And look for more wonderful articles on Philly Sports Network. We got a great team covering Flyers hockey. The founder of Philly Sports Network, Liam Jenkins, has really started getting his hockey groove on, writing some good stuff from England. Then keep up the good work, Liam. You're doing great. The other contributors for the Flyers that have just been absolutely killing it for Philly Sports Network is Ricky Amendeo Alex McIntyre, and of course, Eric Reese, who is always on the spot with breaking news and articles. I can't even keep up with him. He just is throwing out content left and right and really, really driving the ship here in terms of the creativity and productivity of the Flyers team. So again, head on over to Philly Sports Network, check out their work, and give them a like on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Now, I said that as I introduced those wonderful writers for Philly Sports Network, I just want to, as we continue to progress in this show, we are going to have multiple guests come on throughout the year, and we're going to have all those writers come on. So make sure you're familiar with their work before listening, and they bring a lot of good stuff to the table. You may have seen us all together before on the Flyer Zoom Room. We tried to get going back in the spring, but you know, they'll be coming on to share some insight that, you know, and some of their knowledge that maybe I didn't go through, or I did not know at the time. Again, these guys are on top of it. They're on top of all the news, and it's wonderful to see. So they'll be joining us, but I have a really, really great announcement. And my first guest for the podcast is going to be coming up here shortly, and it is no other than Derek Settlemyer. You may know him as Nasty from the Nasty Knuckles web series and podcast, but he's agreed to come on and join me, so I'm hoping to have him on Sunday. If you don't know who Derek is the former equipment manager for the Philadelphia Flyers. Derek has spent over 26 years in the NHL and AHL, mainly, most recently, he was the head equipment manager for the Flyers, and he's worked over 2,000 professional games in his career. He really knows what he's doing. He left last year mid-season, and he's opened up his own business, Settlemyer Skate Sharpening. You can go to SettlemyerSkateSharpening.com. That's SettleMyre. And check out his profile there. And if you play hockey and you're looking to get good quality service on skates, on other equipment, Derek is definitely the guy. But he's got some great stories. I was just down there talking to him today as he was giving me some help with my skates, and just the stories are fantastic. If you don't tune into the Nasty Knuckles podcast, you'll want to, because Derek gives you a great behind-the-scenes look of the personalities of your favorite NHL stars, and he has them on. He's already had Voracek and Provorov on, and he had Craig Berube on. Former Flyer Scotty Hartnell and former enforcer Todd Fedoruk on the episodes they had. It comes out every Monday, so take a listen, and it's definitely going to be worth your time. Again, like I said, the stories are great. I can't wait to get them on. We're going to do so, hopefully have some stories, some extra stories that doesn't make his podcast, but we're also going to talk Flyers hockey because of his knowledge of the sport from all those years. All right, so tune in. That should be coming out hopefully Sunday night, Monday morning, if at the latest Tuesday, if the schedules match up. But that's what we're looking for. Everybody, I hope you have a great day, and let's go Flyers. Sticks Up High is sponsored by Nolan's Poorhouse Coffee, saving lives one cup at a time. You can't work when you're tired, and in some cases, exhaustion can lead to costly mistakes. Hopefully, you pre-planned to fight this fatigue when you picked up some Joe at NolansPoorhouse.com. And if you failed to plan properly, head on over and find the perfect blend to suit your morning or night work routine. Take advantage of our free domestic shipping on orders over $55. Nolan's Poorhouse has been providing great coffee to the local area since 2018. We are a family-owned local company out of Delco. That's Delaware County, if you didn't know. The owners consist of Craig Nolan, a combat veteran, who was a 26-year law enforcement officer, Kim Nolan, a former intensive care unit nurse who turned nurse practitioner, and Ron Flebby, an emergency room nurse who was once a volunteer hose jockey or firefighter. What started out in 2009 as a small basement gathering, Nolan's Poorhouse has since evolved into the current coffee company. The basement setting still exists as a spot for friends to gather and shoot the breeze. The founder, Craig Nolan, is a first Gulf War veteran. He served with the 82nd Airborne Division. Nolzy, as we affectionately call him, stays active by playing hockey. He was the founder of the Tri-State Police Hockey Club, also known as the Slugs, and is a proud member of the Flyers Warriors hockey team. Nolan's Poorhouse is just like the bazillion other veteran and first responder-owned coffees, only we offer a better coffee product. Come see how we're saving lives one cup at a time.